Good morning, Midwest Baptist Church. Our scripture today comes from the 91st chapter of Psalms. I'm going to read the first 10 verses. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler, and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eye shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked.
Thank you, Lord.
Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High thy habitation, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and hearing of His word. I've read to you the first 10 verses of Psalms 91. Let's go to God in prayer this
Amen.
Morning. Gracious Lord, we thank you for your promise and your provision and your protection. That no matter what may come against us, as long as we are under your protection and under the shadow of your wings,
yes, Lord,
you will keep us from falling. You will keep us from dying. You will keep us from truly being destroyed because, well, Lord, we have made you our trust.
Yes, Lord.
We pray today that we'll continue to hold to your unchanging hand.
Wow.
That you will be with Midwest Baptist Church families, friends, that you will be with our nation, our Christian brothers and sisters.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, no matter what may come their way, Lord, we know that we can hold to you and that you will never let us go. We pray, Lord, that you will keep us. Whether we slumber or sleep, we thank you that you will keep us and you will sustain us.
Yes.
And you will protect us. Lord, we thank you most importantly for loving us. We do this in Jesus' name. Lord, we pray that you'll mightily speak to our pastor and, Lord, that you would be with those who are leading this land, are serving in this land. Lord, that you will continue to meet all the needs of your people. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. To God be the glory.
Praise the Lord.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
God is a sovereign God.
He is. Yes, he is.
Let's praise him. Ever. touch me.
Focus primarily on verses 5 through 8, although I will look back at a couple others. So if you will, stand with me while we read verses 5 through 8. And then we'll bow our heads in a word of prayer. Psalm 91, 5 through 8 reads as follows. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand. But it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked.
Yes.
May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and the hearing of his word, And may he give you and I a greater understanding.
Amen.
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 Our subject today is being safe and secure. Our theme all along has been taken from verse 1, you know, in this passage. You know, because when we look at this passage, we see that God is that shelter. When we hide ourselves in the secret place of the Most High. Mm. Now, this is not talking now about after you're dead. Mm. It's not talking about that law. We need to be abiding in the secret place of the Most High right now.
Amen. Amen.
And that's the key. So this passage, you hear it a lot of times, especially the first few verses. At funerals, but this is not talking about when people are dead. It's talking about right now.
Amen.
So the other thought that we have here is God is the shelter of strength, of all strength. You may be seated. Let's bow our heads once again in prayer. Merciful Father, we thank you for what you've done. We thank you for being with us day by day by day.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you for keeping us in your care. But Lord, if it wasn't for you, there would be nothing that we could do. And there is nothing that we can do. But we thank you for what you're doing for us. We ask you to keep us and our families and all of our loved ones. It's in Jesus' name that we pray and ask that you be with us right now as we look in your word. Give us a greater understanding. Help me to present it the way you would have it done. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
God is our strength, which gives us the courage to live in this life.
Mm. Amen.
Do you get that?
Amen. That's true.
God is our strength. You see, we go right quick. God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in a time of trouble. And yes, this is a troublesome life that we live.
Yes,
and God
Lord.
Is that
yes,
strength
Lord.
That it takes for us to live in this life.
Thank you, Lord.
There's a story about some people where a hurricane quickly approached their coastal village. All of the people had hurried to the town shelter. There they were huddled together in a dark little place with the winds howling because that storm hurricane was really moving. Sheets of rain beating down on the house, and the door of the shelter was just about to be ripped from its hinges. People were afraid. Everyone huddled in the shelter had their eyes fixed on the door because the door was shaking, and they knew that if the door came loose, the wind would just suck them out and they would be gone. Then there was an elderly pastor, and he began to pray. And he prayed what's called an effectual fervent prayer of the righteous. This wind was howling, and this elderly pastor began to say, Lord God, send us the spirit that was with the children of Israel when they crossed the Red Sea.
That's all right.
Lord God, send us the spirit that was with them, the other generation, as they began to cross the Jordan River. And then the wind howled again. And the old man stopped. He said, Lord God, this is not a chore for children. I want you to come yourself.
My Lord.
We need you.
Amen.
Isn't that something?
Amen.
I don't know if you can relate, but I can.
I can.
There have been times in my life where I desperately needed God and God alone.
That's right.
To come and help me out.
My Lord.
Life has its twists, its turns, its twirls, its thrills, leaving a person feeling helpless, hopeless, and desperate, in need of a shelter. a shelter that's safe and secure. And that's what this passage is all about. He that dwelleth, what? In the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. And I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust.
Always, my Lord.
Now I want you to notice something. Three words. Three words to note here in this very important couple of verses. The word shelter, the word fortress, and the word refuge. The Hebrew word for shelter means a place to hide from my enemies. Sometimes we need that, don't we?
Amen.
The Hebrew word for refuge means a place to run to for safety. Because if you like the children of Israel, the Pharaoh's army was ready to kill them. The Hebrew word for fortress means the one who keeps me. And that's why we need to understand those words. The psalmist found God in a hiding place, a safe place, a resting place, from all of the trials and the troubles and the temptations and the terrors of this world, because there are a lot of them. We have considered that God is a refuge of rest. But understand that He is also a shelter of strength.
Amen.
God is our shelter. He guards us on all sides.
Amen.
How about that?
Yes.
God guards us on all sides. God is before us. God is behind us.
Yes,
Isaiah 47:48-17 says, "Thus saith the Lord, thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, I am the Lord thy God, which teacheth thee to profit." How about that? God said, "I teach you to profit." These people are running around here thinking that they got it all. But God said, "I'm the one that teach you to profit, which leadeth thee by the way that you should go." Not the way you want to go.
But
the way you should go. Isaiah 30:21 here says, "And thine ears shall hear a word behind thee." Get this. Saying, "This is the way. Walk ye in it." When you turn to the right hand and when you turn to the left. This is God giving you direction. Go this way. Don't go that way. It's the wrong way. Then He is on our right and on our left. Psalms 16:8. The scripture says, "I have set the Lord always before me, because He is at my right hand, and I shall not be moved." Isn't that all right?
Amen.
I've set the Lord before me. I've got God sitting out there before me, and God is going to lead me. God is going to guide me. God is going to direct me, because He knows the way I should go. Job 23:9 says, "On the left where He doeth work, but I cannot behold Him. He hideth Himself on the left hand, and I cannot see Him." God is always above us, and God is always beneath us. Isn't that all right?
Amen.
Listen to what it says in Psalm 36:7. "How excellent is thy loving kindness, O God. Therefore, the children of men put their trust under the shadow of thy wings." Deuteronomy 32:33-27. "The eternal God is thy refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms, and He shall thrust out the enemy from before thee, and shall say, destroy them." How about that? God will thrust out your enemy and said, destroy them, get rid of them. And not only that, God is a spirit on the inside of us. Know that? 1 Corinthians 3:16. Don't you know that the temple of God is in you and the Spirit dwells in you? You're the Spirit of God. Don't you know that you are the temple? And that's all right. The choir sang a song every now and then when I talk about the fact that the Spirit of God is all around you. There's a song, the choir you sing, that he's on the right, he's on the left. God is everywhere.
Amen.
God is our refuge and rest and shelter of strength. Psalms 46, verses 1 through 3. I know we know that one. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in a time of trouble. Therefore will not we fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with swelling thereof. How about that? God is still in charge.
Amen.
God is a shelter of strength and courage. That's what we're talking about in these few verses, verses 5 through 8. He's a shelter of strength and courage. That's what God is.
Amen.
Courage is doing what you're afraid to do.
All right.
Did you get that? Courage is doing what you're afraid to do. There can be no courage unless you're scared. But you know you need to do that. Courage is something we all need, whether we realize it or not.
Hmm. Yes, Lord.
We need it for life.
In this world.
You know why? Because life can be scary.
Amen.
Need to keep that in mind for all times. Courage is something we all need. Now listen to this. On some level, at some point in life, we all have had to realize that we were afraid. And somehow we came through it.
All right.
I will say to you, God was with you.
Always.
Know this. Fear, when you're afraid, fear steals your joy. Fear depletes your strength. When you get afraid, you almost go to your knees. You're weak. Fear paralyzes us with terror.
Say that.
That's why when the angels always came to one of God's people on earth, and when the angel come to you, remember the scripture says, God will give his angels charge over you.
Well,
you know that? What do the angels say when they come to you? Fear not. Maybe you're not listening. But the angel says, fear not. Fact is, we've all had to encounter fear.
Well.
But you don't have to be overcome by fear.
Amen. My Lord.
Sometimes the Lord calms the storm that we're in.
Well,
you've been
that.
In a storm and
yes,
the Lord calms the storm that you're in.
My Lord.
That's right. Sometimes he does that. But then there are other times that he let the storm just rage and calms his child. That's right. That way he knows that you'll know that he can take you through the storm.
Yes, he does.
Courage is running toward your fears, not from your fears.
Well.
How about that? Courage is being scared to death, but saddling up anyway.
My Lord.
Psalm 56:3 in the Living Bible says this. When I'm afraid, I will put my confidence in the Lord. So, there are some things about courage we need to understand. First, the source of courage. Where does the courage come from? In verse 1, the psalmist calls God Elyon, the Most High. Did you know that? That's the word, Elyon, the Most High. And it not only means that, it means possession.
Well,
the implication is that God is the owner of everything in heaven and on earth.
My Lord.
Our God owns it all.
Yes, he does.
For he created it all. Elyon, the Most High, the God of possession, is the source of courage. That's why the courage comes from. Remember what he said to Joshua in Joshua chapter 1, verses 6 through 9? Be strong and of good courage.
Yes, Lord.
For unto this people shalt thou divide for an inheritance the land, which I swear unto thy fathers to give them. Only, listen again, be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law. How about that? To all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded thee.
All right.
Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left. That's that phrase again. Don't turn to the right or to the left. Go straight ahead. Keep marching and doing what I told you to do.
Amen.
That's the only way things are going to work out right. That thou mayest prosper wheresoever thou go. God says if you don't turn to the right and to the left, to the right and the left, you're going to prosper wherever you go. Because God is going to send you to it.
Amen.
Then he tells us about the Bible. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein, that then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success.
Wow.
God is telling us how to be successful.
Thank you, Lord.
Verse 9 says, have I not commanded you? Be strong and of good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee wherever thou goest. Isn't that all right? God wants you to live with assurance, with confidence. God wants you to live with faith and hope. He is your hiding place. God is your safe place. God is our resting place. God is the shelter of courage for all of his people. He is the source. God is the source of courage.
Amen.
He is also, not only that, second, he is the sentry of courage. The sentry is a guard. He watches over. That's what a sentry is. A sentry is a soldier posted at a certain guard post to prevent unauthorized persons from coming in. That could be into your house. That could be into your job. I've given my angels charge over you, he said. How about that?
Amen.
We got these, so we need to thank God for it. God's spirit is the sentry of courage posted over your mind and your heart. Did you get that? God's sentry of courage is posted over your mind and your heart. See, because the devil, he wants your mind.
He wants everything.
He does want that, but he'll never get it. Now, our text paraphrase could say something a little different. God's word says not to be afraid of the terror of the night, nor fear the dangers of the day, nor fear the disease, the darkness of disaster in the midday. Even though thousands fall around you. Did you get that? We've got thousands of people falling around us right now. Isn't that what the word says?
Amen.
A thousand shall fall by thy side, and 10,000.
My Lord.
We've topped those numbers already. The darkness of disaster at midday, you're not to be afraid of it. You're not to be afraid of the fear of disease. Even though these thousands fall around you, even though these evils are around, they will not touch you. You know why?
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
God is my refuge and my strength.
My strength. Amen. Yes.
But you will see what's happening to them. That's what the scripture says at the end of verse 8. You'll see it with your eyes. The protection that God has on you as he guards you. We'll get through this pandemic.
Oh, yes, Lord.
We're going to get through it. And we're going to pray for those who are being affected by it. Paul speaks of this divine sentry who stands guard, because Paul speaks of it in Philippians 4, 6 through 8. Listen to this. Be careful. I mean, don't worry. Don't be anxious for anything. But in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your request be made known unto God, and the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your heart and mind through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, and if there be any virtue, and if there be anything that's worthy of praise, think on these things.
Amen.
Some people worry and go out of their mind because they're thinking on the wrong stuff all the time. We need to think on the right stuff.
Amen.
Verse 8, Paul says, don't let the fears of this world occupy your mind, but rather let the things of God occupy your mind. In verse 2, the psalmist calls God Elohim. You see why he said, my God? That's Elohim. Elohim also means power. It speaks of the sovereignty of God. Remember the song, Sovereign? The majesty, the splendor, the power of God. There's another story I heard. During the Civil War, a Union soldier from Ohio was shot in the arm. And his captain saw that he was shot, and here he was wounded and bleeding, and he called out an order to him, give me your gun, give me your gun. He said, sir, private, give me your gun and get to the rear. So the private, he gave him his rifle, and he was trying to get to the rear. But as he went to the rear seeking safety, but after going about 200 or 300 yards, he ran into another battle back there. So that didn't work. So he ran to the east and found himself in another skirmish of the battle. Then he ran west, but he encountered another fighting going on right there. Finally, this young private ran back to the front. And after he got to the front, he said to his captain, give me back my rifle. There is no rear in this war. There's no place to run. Do you remember when you look at Ephesians 6? There is nothing to protect the back. Nothing. That's why we need to keep going forward. Keep doing what God said. That's what he said. Then he said, there's no rear back there. Brothers and sisters, just in case you haven't discovered it yet, there's no rear in this battle called life. You might as well continue to go forward, but make sure you're going in the way that God is directing you to go. The third thing, yes, there's a shelter, a refuge, and a fortress. That's God himself. But let me tell you the third thing. The sustainer of courage is also God. To keep in existence, that's what sustain means. God keeps us in existence to maintain us. Verse 1, the Psalms calls us something, calls God something else. El Shaddai. How about that? That is the Almighty God. The provision. The implication is that God supplies all of our needs, that he is the one who sustains us in life. He is the provider of all and for all. In verse 2, the psalmist calls him also the Lord. That's Jehovah. He calls him the Lord, and Jehovah is promised. The first thing he promised, hey, listen, salvation is coming your way. The idea here is that God is the absolute, eternal, and unchanging one. Therefore, he will sustain his own for that which he has promised. God will always do that. God is the source of courage.
Amen. Amen.
Keep that courage. Don't. That's why the angel says, be not afraid. There are a lot of people afraid today. The sentry of courage, and he is the sustainer of courage, for he has promised to provide for his own. Verse 8 said, you will see it with your eyes. Mm. What are we going to see? I mean, we'll see how the others are destroyed. And we're still kept here. I don't know nothing about those people who died. None whatsoever. But I tell you, I believe that a lot of this has come forth because people have put God out of everything.
Amen.
I give you another thought here. Verse 8 talks about seeing it with your eyes. But there's a story about a soldier who fought in Desert Storm. He received a letter. And this was a terrible letter. He was very much in love with his fiancée. He got this Dear John letter from his girlfriend, and to add insult to injury, she wrote to him and said, will you please return my favorite photograph of myself? I need it for my engagement picture for the local newspaper. That really hurt. The poor guy was devastated, but all of the soldiers were his friends. All of the soldiers came to his rescue. They went throughout the entire camp and collected every picture of all of those guys' girlfriends. And they filled up the entire shoebox and sent it to the girl with a note from the guy. He says, please find your picture, honey, and return the rest to me. I can't remember which one is you. So you send me those back. Aren't you glad that God remembers you?
Yes.
Aren't you glad that God knows your name? Aren't you glad that God knows where you are, when and where you're going? He knows all there is to know about you. God is a shelter of strength for all who will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart. And you that hope in God, stand firm in the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
To God be the glory. We thank God for each and every one of you, and we asking God to continue to keep us. But let me say this. For all those who don't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, believe you me, it is time to get to know Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
He said, the day you hear my voice, harden not your heart.
My Lord.
You need to ask Jesus to come into your heart and to save you. Believe you me, you need Jesus Christ. When you do that, you are safe and secure. But the only way to be safe and secure is in Jesus Christ. Ask him to come into your life, to save you, and to be your Lord. And Jesus will do that.
Amen.
Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Amen. To God be the glory. Continue to look at today and think about all that Jesus has done. One of the things we do, some say we take three looks when we do this. We look back at what the Lord did for us on the cross. Mm-hmm. Then we'll look within and examine ourselves. And not only that, we are to look forward, because Jesus came the first time, we know that he's coming back again. And that's what we are celebrating today. This is a solemn time. This is a time when we should feel closest to the Lord. But if it's not, let us continue to work on that. Ask God to help us to love him better, to help us to worship him better, to help us to walk closer with him day by day. Amen?
Amen.
We're going to read a few verses of scripture, then I'm going to ask Deacon West to pray for us. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning at verse 23, the Word of God says this: For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After the same manner, also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show forth the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink of this cup of the Lord unworthily, he shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and hearing of his word, and may he give us understanding.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for dying on the cross for our sins. We thank you that we can partake in the communion. And Lord, we look forward, Lord, to when we see you again. We thank you for dying on the cross for our sins. We thank you that we have this ordinance that we can continue to just observe in remembrance of what you've done for us. We pray, Lord, that you will bless each and every one of us partaking.
Yes, Lord.
Help us to continue to look steadfastly to you. In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Amen. We want to make sure that we know and we understand. Never forget what the Lord did for us. The Lord, at the supper table, he took the bread and he broke it. He said, take this, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Has anybody been overlooked? Let us commune together. After supper, he took the cup and said, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. New Testament, new covenant, same word. And one of the things that's most important, he said, anybody that take this bread and drink of this cup of the Lord unworthily, they're guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. Has anybody been overlooked? Let's come in together. Exceedingly abundantly above all that ye ask or even think.
My Lord.
According to the power that worketh within us. Lord, that's amazing to me. You said according to the power that works within us. Unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Amen.